So I think I'll start with the introduction of today's speaker. So today we are going to have a webinar on tympanometry. We're trying to go on the basics of audiology to start with, and in coming weeks, if the lockdown continues, we will go ahead and have some more higher level topics like maybe electrophysiology or other topics as such. And even in speech side, we are trying to get speech and language topics. Hopefully next week we'll have some more topics. We are still working towards that. As and when we can confirm it, we'll let you know. So today's topic is tympanometry, and we are trying to do basics of tympanometry with clinical application. And hopefully this topic will be applicable to everybody, so that, you know, as soon as the lockdown is over, we can utilize what we have learned today. So today's speaker is Anup Gimire. He's been working as a research and clinical audiologist at Green Pasture Hospital, Pokhara. He's completed his postgraduate studies from All India Institute of Speech and Hearing, where he did his undergrad studies as well. There's a number of publications to his name, and I hope we'll have a wonderful session today, and I'll pass it on to Anup now. So over to you.
Hello, good evening everyone. It's me, Anup Gimire. Thank you for beautiful introduction, Vivek sir. So hope you all are fine and staying inside your home. So I feel like tympanometry is the most fascinating and very fast to do perform test in audiology. So as we all know, we have gone through the pneumatic otoscope, where we have seen like we are observing the tympanic membrane movement with the applied pressure through the pneumatic otoscope. It is unlike that, tympanometry, we are using the various pressure, but we are not trying to observe the movement of the tympanic membrane. So in this process, what we are observing is like with the varying pressure, how much energy is passing throughout our middle ear system, and how much energy is reflecting back through the middle ear system. So in this process, if we go back to the history, Bekesi was the first person to use this system to evaluate the cochlear sensitivity by changing the ear pressure. But he didn't try to see the more from the view of middle ear pathology. After 20 years from this, Bekesi around 1930, he did this research. After 20 years, Automeds was the first to study to differentiate middle ear disease by using the sound bridge, and it's a tympanum like a imitance audiometry. Today I'll be trying to discuss more about the basics and the instrumentation, tympanogram, static complaints, physical volume, multi-frequency and the multi-component acoustic reflex. I'll be highlighting on these topics more. So imitance is the general term used to describe how well energy flows through a system. So we know that it hardly takes more than 5 minutes to perform the imitance. So it can be used in the children also. It is non-behavioral test. It can be used in the babies, very small babies also. So it tells about the different middle ear status, and it also evaluates the reflex pathways, and it can give all the information from our cochlear nucleus, then auditory nerve, then superior olivary complex, and to the efferent pathways, facial nerve, and back to the stapedius muscles. It gives all the information, and it cross-checks the PTA finding, and this helps especially on the pseudo hypocrisis. So those who are malingering, in that cases, if we use this reflex, then we'll get to get an idea about either that person is malingering or not. So this helps in the cross-checking the PTA finding. So middle ear, we know like external ear, we can easily view with the otoscope, but middle ear from nowhere, from the Sturgeon tube also, from the external auditory canal also we cannot view. So tympanometry helps us to examine this closed middle ear space from the outer ear canal. So before understanding the tympanometry and the concept, we have to know about these things. Ear pressure must be same, like in order to pass all the energy from the external ear to the middle ear and to the inner ear, the pressure from the external ear and the middle ear, it should be same from the both the side. So in this time, this create the least stiff and the most compliance. That means energy will be, sound energy will be easily passing to the middle ear. So before understanding the different aspect of the impedance, we have to understand this physics. If we have the three system in our system, mass, stiffness and resistance, the blockage of energy due to mass we called as a mass reactance, and the blockage due to stiffness or the spring system, then we called it as a stiffness reactance, and the due to the rough surface we called as a resistance, or our resistance is mainly due to the heat loss. And so impedance, if you see the emittance, it has two concepts. One is the impedance and the another is a admittance. Impedance basically it is defined as a opposition to flow of energy in a system. So if we are observing the how much sound is opposing, if we applied the pressure, then if we are studying that, then it is the impedance measurement. Whereas admittance is like how much energy is passing through the system with the varying pressure, then that study is called admittance. So impedance and admittance, there are the few factors which I just discussed here: mass, stiffness and the resistance for the impedance. So mass reactance is the opposite due to the mass in the system, and the stiffness reactance is opposition due to the stiffness in a system, stiffness, and the resistance due to the friction. So similarly, all the component will be opposite for the admittance. So in our system, if you see the see in the middle ear, so mass is contributed mainly by the middle ear ossicles, and the stiffness due to load of fluid pressure from the inner ear on the stapes foot plate, and the resistance is ligament of the middle ear ossicles. So what we have to understand is our middle ear bones are very tiny and very low in mass, so it doesn't contribute more in our impedance or emittance evaluation. Whereas stiffness, the middle ear we have already studied, like middle ear transformer actions. That means like our inner ear fluid is stopping the movement of the middle ear. So it has high stiffness and it has very low mass, and resistance is very negligible. So in normal adult middle ear is more mainly stiffness dominated system. So we have to keep this in mind, and we'll come back to this point again. So what we use in regularly, like admittance or the impedance, we should know that admittance uses automatic gain control, which means like if you are pressing giving probe tone in the external ear, it assesses the SPL in the, it measures the SPL in the ear canal and it balances that. Whereas impedance meter, it doesn't, it depends on the SPL on the ear canal. So if you plot the tympanogram by using impedance meter, the due to the various canal sizes, SPL will be varying. So the tympanogram will be different. I think if I want to simplify that, if we want to measure through impedance meter instead of admittance, SPL sizes, SPL due to varying in SPL with the different canal sizes, the tympanogram shape will be varied. So it doesn't have a uniformity, But whereas admittance uses AGC, AGC automatic gain control, which is not based on the different canal sizes. So if we measure impedance or the if we measure the tympanogram with the admittance, it doesn't affect. It is not affected by the ear canal size. So I think this makes clear, like, most of the newer devices are based on the admittance, not from the not in the impedance. And another aspect is like admittance. If you want to calculate the admittance here, I think I'll show with the pointer. So if we want to measure admittance, calculation of admittance in the middle ear is very easy. And whereas the calculation of impedance in the middle ear through impedance is very difficult. So how it works, how we can measure these things? So first thing, what we have to understand is we have three tiny holes for the three different things. First thing, what we have to make in our mind is we need to have one probe tone, which is around 226 hertz most of the time, 226 hertz, which will constantly give 226 hertz probe tone with 85 decibel sound. And next thing is what we are measuring is how much sound is bouncing back from the tympanic membrane. And that bouncing back sound pressure level we are measuring through the microphone or recorder, and which we are will be analyzing through our system. And the third thing is air pump. Air pump constantly give the air pressures from the positive air pressure to the room air pressure to the negative air pressures through the to the ear canal. So if you give the positive pressure, it will make stiff system, stiff to the tympanic membrane, and most of the energy will be reflecting back. If it is a room temperature, room pressure, almost maximum energy will be going or passing through the system. So if we want to see our probe tip will be having three holes, and one more extra holes will be there for the ipsilateral reflex testing. We'll be discussing it later. So these things I already have told about, this probe, monitor, microphone to record the sound, reflected sound or bounce back sound, then pressure pump to give the various pressure, and probe tone loudspeaker which give the constant 226 hertz at 85 dBSPL. So next thing is, like, it is in detail how it works. I think this also not required much. Like microphone, what we, like first we are giving the probe tone speaker, which is probe tone is generated by the oscillator, then amplifier, then it gives through the probe tip. And the second is the air pump or pressure transducer, which gives the various pressure. And then third system is to give the ipsilateral ipsi speaker, which means, like, if we want to measure the ipsilateral reflexes, so we should have the one more speaker for that, for providing the stimulus for the reflexes. And whatever bounces bounce back from the ear canal, we have to measure by using the microphone, and which is analyzed by the processor. So we know that we are using almost all the time 226 hertz tone. Why not 250, and why not 500, 600, 700? So for this, to answer that, calibration calibrated, like, 226 hertz tone are used to calibrate the admittance. So thus, what is this mean by is, when this meter indicate the admittance of ear is 1.8 mmHOS at 226 hertz, admittance of the correspondent that ear canal volume is ear, that volume of ear is 1.8. What is this is, like, when meter indicate that the admittance of the ear is 1.8 mmHOS millimoles at 226 hertz, this means that the ear in that canal is 1.8 ml of volume. So we have seen that our calibration tube were 1 cc, 2 cc, 3 cc. If we are using in the 1 cc, that means admittance value of 1 equals to 1 ml of air volume. So I think this makes clear why we are using 226 hertz. But 226 hertz, our most of the, one more reason is like our system is most of the time stiffness dominated system. So if you are using the low frequency 226 hertz tone, it gives the better idea about our middle ear system. But in case of children, if we are using 226 hertz, then it won't give the clear idea. As we know, the children's ossicles and the external ear, that bony canal, it is not completely ossified. So in children, it is mostly mass dominated system. So because of that, if you use the 226 hertz, it won't give the clear picture about their middle ear status. Whereas if you, instead of using the low frequency, if you use the high frequency probe tone, then it gives the clear idea. Even if you are using 226 hertz tone for the ossicular chain dysfunction or the otosclerosis, instead of using this, if you use the higher frequency probe tone, that might give the better idea about the condition or the disease. So we'll be again discussing to that point. So 85 dB, why we are not using 90 dB SPL, 100 dB SPL? The answer is that while measuring the tympanometry, if you use the high SPL, then 85 or 90, it obviously 85 or 90, it might activate the our stapedius muscles. So they have found like 85 or the 70, some of the researchers I have found like 70 dB also they have used. So if you use the high SPL, it will reduce that complaints value will be reducing. So he is the automates testing the patient with the bridge. So if we want to measure the tympanometry, there are mainly four important tests which we have to measure. One is the tympanogram, second is a static compliance, then physical volume of the ear canal and the acoustic reflexes. So tympanogram, we all know tympanogram. So in tympanogram, it is a graph plotted against pressure and compliance value. Pressure we are giving from the 300 plus 200 to minus 400. And what we have to imagine here is this maximum peak. What it indicates is like when we have 200, when pressure is 200, it is making our ear eardrum or the tympanic membrane maximum stiff. And because of maximum stiff, it acts as a hollow cavity, means one cavity which is reflecting all the sound. That means it has a lowest complaints. That means it has a lowest admittance, which means it is not allowing energy to pass to the middle ear system. Hello? Yes?
Continue, yeah.
When we are reducing from the 200 to the room pressure, that is around 0 DAPA or 0 mm2o. So in that 0 or the room pressure, the energy flow through the middle ear is maximum. We can see in the A, the maximum complaints, that this means that energy is almost maximally, it is going through the system and it is minimally reflecting. It is not reflecting or the bouncing back the SPL to the microphone from which we are going to measure. And if you go to the negative pressure, if you decrease the pressure toward the negative direction, or if we are pulling back the pressure from the our external auditory canal, what it does is again it makes our tympanic membrane maximum stiff and all it reflected all the energy to our microphone. So This gives a clear idea about how well energy is passing through the system. One more important point what we have to think is, like, it is very amazing to know that with the external ear we are getting to know about the pressure in the middle ear. So pressure in the middle ear, how we are finding the pressure in the middle ear is like when you have maximum stiff tympanic membrane, that time it will maximally reflect the maximally reflect the energies to the microphone, which is in external ear. So that gives the clear idea about the external ear admittance, or the admittance of the contribution from the external ear. And if we reduce with the maximum energy which is passing while it is at the room pressure, so if we just subtract with the this value, it gives about the middle ear stat, how well middle ear is functioning. So with the tympanogram, with the different shape of the tympanogram, gives the different idea about middle ear conditions. Type A normally it indicates in the normal, and type AD is like hypermobile tympanic membrane, which is ossicular discontinuity if someone have ossicular discontinuity. And AS is like if atherosclerosis is there, which is blocking, which our energy is not passing or easily it is not going through the system, which you can see here. I told like this maximum point indicate, it is how well energy is passing inside. So here in A type, it is more energy is going when AS, or the due to ossicular fixation or the mass in the foot plate of the step is, the energy passing is less, so we can easily correlate. Whereas in the discontinuity, that energy is that our ossicles are moving fastly, so AD type of tympanogram will get in the ossicular chain discontinuity. So if we see the B type of tympanogram, so otitis media, it gives about the otitis media, occluded cerumen perforation. So how it gave out the otitis media is, we can see here, I want to highlight to this point. So if someone have normal, so at room pressure, we can get the maximum compliance value, or the maximum at compliance we can get at the room pressure. When slightly tympanic membrane is retracted, it will go toward the negative, and sequentially, if retraction is more, it will go toward the very deep negative pressure. So initial, then next step in the fluid is like if moderate fluid is started accumulating at that point, so it will start becoming round from the peak. So again, if fluid is more, then we can see the progression. So from this point, what I want to highlight is, like, with this tympanogram we can see the, we can get an idea about the how disease is progressing, and even we can see the how after the treatment how well is the system working with the medication. We can get to know about that idea from tympanometry also. And another is like otitis media, if they have otitis media or the fluid, then maximum energy, as I told, maximum B type it indicates maximum energy is bouncing back and we are getting through the microphone, and energy are not passing through the middle ear completely. So occluded cerumen, if someone have wax, impacted wax also, we can get the B type of tympanogram. And perforation or the patulous Stetson tube, what we have is like if B type with the ear canal, higher ear canal volume, that that we can tell that it is perforated. If it is very high, around 6-7, then we can tell that Stetson tube is all open all the time, which is patulous Stetson tube. And if someone have atherosclerosis, advanced atherosclerosis, cholestatoma and head trauma also might get B type of tympanogram. And type C already, while discussing in this figure, I have told like type C is like when we have
pressure. Excuse me, Anup.
Yes.
Yeah.
We'll leave the meeting for now, and I'll request everybody to click on the same link, and we'll continue again.